Hello and welcome to the PCC Today Show. I'm Charla Robertson and we are talking about the Educational Master Plan. Last episode was to be continued and this episode we are continuing that very discussion all about sustainability. And when I say sustainability, I mean student sustainability as well as environmental sustainability here on campus. We'll also be talking about revenue enhancement, grants, and extended learning, and so much more right here after the break.
Hi, and we're back. Again, we're talking about the Educational Master Plan here at Pasadena City College, and the topic is revenue enhancement. And the person I have to my left here knows a lot about revenue enhancement, Dr. Lisa Sugimoto, the Vice President of College Investment. Lisa, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you, Juan. It's a pleasure to be here today.
Now, you have the task, whether you accept it or not, to raise funds here at Pasadena City College to augment the kind of depressing thing we're hearing out of Sacramento on funding. So I know you got lots of brilliant ideas. So talk to us about a couple of those.
Well, we have a couple of wonderful campaigns going on right now, and I can talk to you about those. So first, let me talk to you a little bit about the Osher Challenge. Now, the state of California has given us a wonderful match challenge for our students to receive scholarships. Anyone who donates to our college in view of the Osher Challenge will have their scholarship then enhanced 50% of what they donate.
Wow.
And those will go back to our students in scholarships in perpetuity.
Perpetuity. So if we meet this challenge, we're going to have a lot of scholarship funds for our students for years and years to come.
We'll be receiving approximately $100,000 a year to give back to our students for a very long time. Perpetuity is a long time.
It is. I think it's forever.
I think so too.
All right, great. Well, tell us a little bit about the campaign you guys just launched, which is Raise Your Hand for PCC.
Yes. Well, we have a great campaign going on right now, which is going to be our annual fund campaign. And it really is to bring back our alums and our community to understand that the college really supports who they are and what we have done for them. It is Raise Your Hand for PCC. We started that campaign back January 1st with our big banner during the Rose Parade, and we're hoping for all the alums that are out there, all of you that are out there, that you will join in this wonderful campaign to support PCC. And not just in scholarships, because the college has quality education, and right now, given the state of our economy in California, we're not able to provide the kind of support that we're used to and giving our students the type of educational environment that we would love to give. So we're hoping for enhanced revenue to provide resources for our students and our faculty to continue to provide and to enhance the education that we do give to our community and to our students.
Now, the great thing about this campaign and the foundation in general is you don't have to be a millionaire to really make a difference in a student's life. I mean, you can give a little bit, you can give a lot, you can give some of your time and expertise. Lisa, what other options if, say, I'm not Rockefeller, how can I really help PCC?
Well, we have planned giving opportunities through bequests, so we know that many people do not have cash on hand right now. So they may have other assets that they want to give, and perhaps later on in their wills or their trusts, they may decide that, hey, I'm going to remember PCC. So that's one way they can also give. Also, what we're finding is many people decide that they want to give a dollar a month. Every dollar makes a difference. And in fact, an example of that is many of our employees have decided on a monthly basis to have an amount donated back to the college as part of their payroll deduction. And every month they give to us. And it makes a difference for our students and for the college. So thank you for asking that question, Juan.
No, it's great. I mean, everyone can make a difference. Whether you came here, whether your son or daughter came here, your grandparents, it seems that everyone in not only San Gabriel, but Los Angeles has had a experience with Pasadena City College.
It appears when you ask people, someone has had their lives touched by PCC. I was a student here many years ago, and I will always remember that experience because PCC made a difference in my life. And so I'm willing to raise my hand for PCC.
Well, thank you so much, Lisa. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Juan, very much.
We'll be right back. Hi, and we're back. Well, we've been talking about the educational master plan, and one of the big components is revenue enhancement. So how can an institution like PCC enhance revenue? Well, we have a proud past, and that means alumni. A lot of famous people have come here, like Jackie Robinson and Jaime Escalante. So we're going to go after more of our alumni so they feel more connected to the institution. And with me is Irene Aguilera, our alumni person. Irene, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Juan.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the plan. I know that we've always had a very robust alumni connection with everyone that's come through here, but are there any plans in the future to maybe have them more connect more with the college?
Absolutely. In fact, one of the things we're working on now is our annual campaign, which is Raise Your Hand for PCC. We want to connect with the community, and as you mentioned, we have a number of people who have gone through PCC and are so happy and proud. You know, when we talk about making an investment in your community, it's not an abstract at all. What we're talking about is the people that fix your cars, people that you go to the dentist and they're your dental hygienists, sometimes your dentists, your nurses. So, you know, it's an important thing to really invest in our alumni and in PCC. And one of the things that we'll be doing is having alumni come back to help us out with this grassroots campaign and raise some funds for PCC.
Well, I know it's really nice that you mentioned that the alumni that come through PCC are our nurses, the people out there in the community. It's not just the John Singletons who, you know, came here. So, John, if you've got some money, please throw it our way. But it's all about community. It's all about coming back. And we want to bring them back to the campus family, do we not?
Absolutely, absolutely. And there are a number of ways. It's not just, you know, writing a check, although that's a good thing, too. We need people to come and help us mentor. People can volunteer with the various schools and disciplines that they've come through. Geology has a very active Dana Club, and they do field trips. They have fundraisers. People that have gone through that program, it would be great if they came back and helped out. So,
well, let's talk about how we people can become involved. How can they reach out to us as we reach out to them? So how can they get in touch with you and the college in general?
You can always give me a call. I'm at 626-585-7468, and that's the alumni office, 626-585-7468. You can email me, alumni@pasadena.edu. You can look us up on the website and just click on pasadena.edu and then alumni, and you'll find us there.
Well, excellent, Irene. Thank you so much for talking to us. And to all you alumni out there watching this, don't be a stranger. We'd love to have you back. We'll be right back. Well, we're back, and I'm with one of the most popular and in-demand people on campus here at PCC, Nancy Robert, our grant specialist. Nancy, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure, Juan.
Well, tell us, grants are free money, is it not? And everyone loves free money. So tell me a little bit about what you do.
Well, we try and find opportunities to support the students and the activities of the college. And I would say that the Educational Master Plan offers us a lot of areas that match grant opportunities, whether it's creating new student support services or new curriculum or faculty development. All of those have grants that can be applied for that relate to those areas.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned the EMP. So your area probably touches so much of this campus. I mean,
Absolutely.
You probably have instructors coming to you saying, we would like to do this, and your job, for the most part, is to find the resources so we can make that happen.
That's exactly right. And interestingly enough, recently, since the master plan has been in the works, we've seen quite an upswing in the calls that I'm receiving.
I can imagine.
Lots of people I've never really talked to about grants before, saying, how do I do this? You know, where do I find opportunities? What do I do once I find them? So we're trying to get everybody up to speed for that.
And, you know, the EMP talks about revenue enhancement, but also out of Sacramento, the news is kind of, well, depressing about the funding for higher education. So I can just imagine how your phone's blowing up and how much you're in demand.
Absolutely. And in spite of what's happening in Sacramento, there are plenty of opportunities out of Washington and elsewhere. And many of them are recurring opportunities. So I'm trying to tell people to make themselves aware of these opportunities that they might apply for this year or next year or however.
So can you mention maybe some of the grants that PCC has received maybe in the last couple of years, some of the, and actually what they go to fund?
Okay. One of the biggest sources that we've had has been from the U.S. Department of Education in a number of areas. One is Title V. Mm-hmm. And we got our first Title V in the year 2000. And we've just secured another one of those. And they provide us with a lot of innovative programs for our students, like first-year experience programs, specialized instruction in mathematics and other key subjects, those kinds of things. We also have a number of what are called the TRIO programs. One of those is our PASS program, which has been on the campus for 20 years now.
Wow.
We also have two Upward Bound programs, and we just submitted an application for a program called Talent Search, which is also out of the same federal office.
And what does Talent Search fund?
It funds helping high school students to increase their ability to enter college, and it's meant to serve about 500 students from area high schools.
That's excellent. Now, Nancy, again, because of the way the economy is, not only do we have to find, you know, funds to do some of these programs, but we also want to become a global community college. Mm-hmm. So are there any funds out there out of the federal government that might help us reach that, whether through a distance education or somewhere else?
There are certainly funds for distance education. There are funds for international programs. There are funds for our language programs. We're working on something right now with that division, as a matter of fact.
Well, excellent. I know that people like you all over the community college system, UC, CSUs, private and public, are so in demand. We are just so happy to have you. Thank you so much.
I appreciate it. Thank you, Juan.
And we'll be right back. Hi, and we're back. We've been talking about the Educational Master Plan here at PCC, and key to the plan is to offer education to our students and the community in the way they want it. With me to talk about extended learning is Interim Dean of External Relations, Elaine Chapman. Elaine, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Juan. It's a pleasure to be here this afternoon.
Well, tell us a little bit about what extended learning is.
Well, extended learning has been with the college for more than 20 years. It started out as a program that was for the community and offered a variety of classes. Through the years, it has grown both in scope and in depth. And what it is, in essence, is a fee-based program within the state of California. We refer to that as community education. Here at PCC, we call it extended learning. But we run the gamut for classes that are for enjoyment, for interest, for career development, and we even have travel classes, so it's a broad range of classes.
Well, with the Educational Master Plan, there are a lot of possibilities on how we can deliver education to our students in the 21st century. What do you see extended learning transforming to, or what opportunities does extended learning get with the EMP?
Well, as I mentioned, extended learning has been a part of the college for many, many years, decades in essence. However, going forward, we are talking more globally in terms of extension programs. This hopefully will look a lot more like what occurs on our UC campuses as well as on our Cal State campuses, and will be broader in both its scope as well as in its delivery mechanisms. And we do offer a wealth of classes now. In addition to what we have, we're looking at career classes, at classes that will provide for certificates for individuals seeking employment in a variety of fields. We're looking at classes that will assist those within careers to gain continuing education units, and they need that for ongoing certification in the medical fields and the law fields and in areas in which they hold licenses. Another area that we are looking at is broadening our ability to deliver classes to our international students that are coming in for ESL programs, readying them to move into a more academic program. So we have a lot of opportunity, as well as those that would put us in partnership with the corporate players within the community to be able to provide, under the umbrella of extension in the many areas in which that we'll touch upon, classes that will help employers to be certain that their workforce, their staffs, are educated and have the training that they need to provide services to their customers.
Well, Lane, you touched upon continuing education, and a lot of people don't know this, but when the economy is bad like it is now, the demand for higher education just goes skyrocketing. So you touched upon employers or employees coming to community colleges and just getting that one class to help with their skill set, right?
That's true, Juan. As a matter of fact, there is a variety of different options. One will be those corporate customers that need their workforce trained in a particular area. For instance, how to answer the phone or how to deliver good customer service. For some individuals, they'll come to us to learn how to put a resume together, how to use online services to look for a job, how to interview and present themselves in the best possible light. For others, they'll be coming in to get some retraining. They already have degrees, they already have skills, but they're looking for some programs that will enable and assist them to get back into that workforce as quickly as possible. So in essence, we are making that offering to our broader community that supports the greater need and certainly supports that which is happening within the credit classes.
Well, Elaine, thank you so much for spending some time with us and explaining what extended learning is here at PCC.
Juan, it's been my pleasure. Thank you so very much for having me this afternoon.
And we'll be right back. Hi, we're back. Well, we're continuing our conversation about the educational master plan here at Pasadena City College, and now we're going to focus on sustainability. With me is the Dean of Engineering and Technology, Mr. Doug Haynes. Doug, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Sustainability in our programs, not only in the future with the education master plan, the leadership towards green jobs, developing more areas. Presently, we have courses in development in alternative fuels. We have courses set up presently offered in photovoltaic installation, training, very successful. In all of our classes, architectural, building, engineering, we're training with the idea that students have, when they go into the marketplace, they are a green plumber, a green architect, a green welder, which means they offer their clients opportunities to use sustainable products. They explain to them the options related to cost benefits, how it's going to help in the short term, long term. So we believe training people to think, training people to offer the public the right solutions is what we're all about. And it is across the board. Everybody is involved in it, in our training, in our design, and in the materials we use and introduce to our students.
You know, PCC has garnered awards for its sustainability, but it's very important to offer these programs to our students. Now, could you tell me a little bit about what the future holds for engineering and technology and PCC in the green classroom?
Well, green classroom future is that we'll be installing solar panels the second time on our home that is currently under instruction. In fact, history says we did that in 1977.
Oh, wow.
On one of our model homes here. We're expanding the laboratory for the photovoltaic, developing an outside space as well as mock roofs so the students can understand that. Futures are materials courses is the next step. Materials that are coming online for manufacturing, for use in building, product design, vehicle manufacture are lighter, more efficient. They have to be cast, mold, milled, all with the idea that they're going to last a long time and not hurt the environment.
And see, Doug touched upon our construction program, which actually has our students building homes around Bonnie, around the college, and other places. So the fact that this new home is getting greenified, as I like to call it, is a great thing.
Well, it's continuing with what we've been doing. Like I said, the first home with solar, found an article in our history, 1978. So the training has been entrenched. We're continuing to move now getting more in alternate fuels. We have to deal with the hybrid, the electric car. Service to this point had been go to the dealer, take care of it. Now with the volume of the vehicles out there, the commonality of the service requirements from safety to the batteries to the electronics to the charging systems, courses are being put together and will come online next fall regarding alternative fuels and how to fix, repair, and be safe with those.
It's really great to see that PCC is really a leader in sustainability and in the classroom. So as these classes become more and more desirable, PCC is going to meet the demand.
We are. We've expanded cycling our photovoltaic programs to offer more gateway courses, get people in, let them see if they really want to focus on it, and then move to the second level, which is designed not only to get them ready for the marketplace, but to train them in entry-level skills so they can get national certification, a common certification from the Installers Association to take those skills and be mobile around the globe.
Excellent. Well, Doug, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure as always.
We'll be right back.
And we're back, and I'm talking today with Jamie Hammond, the president of Associated Students here at PCC, and we're talking about sustainability and how it affects the educational master plan here on campus. So, Jamie, what is AS doing in terms of sustainability here on campus?
Well, luckily we're doing a lot of things right now in regards to sustainability. We appointed our very first vice president of sustainability just a couple of months ago. And so Hannah Israel is the new vice president of sustainability. She sits on the board with us, and she has the ability now to vote in favor or vote on issues in board meetings that favor sustainability. So now we have a voice for that issue around our board. And now, because she has the position, she has a committee, we're going to be having even more events than we had last semester. Last semester we had something in conjunction with a couple other classes and the Seeds of Change Club. We had something called the Think Before You Buy event, where we had a very large clothing swap. We had a week of different events, everything from a movie screening called What Would Jesus Buy with Reverend Billy Talon, who actually came and performed here on campus. Mm-hmm. We had a bunch of bands, we had a fashion show, and so that was the big end of the semester event in regards to sustainability. This semester, in the spring, we're going to have Julia Butterfly Hill, who is known for tree sitting. She's going to be coming on campus and speaking as well, and so that's going to be one of the big events, and we're going to see clothing swaps. We're going to see lots of great events that Hannah's going to be putting on with her committee in regards to sustainability.
Wow, that is a lot of past and future events coming up here. So what exactly does sustainability benefit students and benefit PCC?
Well, when you talk about sustainability, we look at sustainability as a three-issue sort of deal. And so when you talk about sustainability, it means economic wellness, social wellness, and environmental wellness. And we believe that we and the EPA and everybody else who looks at sustainability as a large issue, believe that you can't have one without having the other. And so to truly have a sustainable world, you have to have all three issues met. And so because we feel like that's something that we need to focus on the grander scheme of things for the world here on campus, when you institutionalize sustainability, mm-hmm. when you make it something that all the students can participate in on a campus, then they may not notice it when they're here on campus, but when they leave here, they'll wonder, and they might start asking questions like, why don't they recycle here? Why don't they do this? Why don't they do this the way that we did at Pasadena City College? And it may inspire students that will leave here to change their own world once they move on somewhere else. And so that's what we believe is the importance of sustainability here, besides just making our impact for the world.
Excellent. So what exactly can students do here on campus besides all those excellent activities you named previously? What can they do here to help with sustainability?
Well, besides coming to the events, we have a sustainability committee, like I mentioned, and we'll be there will be an application period at the beginning of the spring where people will be added into the committee. So if you're interested in being a part of that, that's always a possibility. There's a club called Seeds of Change. Seeds of Change is a great club to get involved with. There are environmental science classes that are great to take just to understand the current state of the world. And if you aren't interested in any of that, we always recommend reusing before recycling. So if you want to we think it's better to bring a bagged lunch and bring it in something that is reusable over and over again, and instead of buying a water bottle and a container that you'll just throw away. So we certainly recommend reusing products as much as possible. And if you want to recycle something, there are brown bins all over the campus that you can recycle bottles and paper in.
Wow, thank you so much, Jamie. That was an excellent talk and interview here about sustainability. And remember, guys, reduce, reuse, and recycle. And we'll be back with more on the Educational Master Plan here on the PCC Today Show.
Hi, and we're back, and we're continuing our discussion about the Educational Master Plan here at PCC, and to talk about counseling, which is very important to freshmen coming into PCC or any college, is Dr. Cynthia Olivo, the Associate Dean of Counseling and Student Success Services. Thanks so much for joining us, Cynthia.
No problem.
Well, what exactly is counseling for people who might not know?
Well, we provide guidance and help for students who are enrolling, continuing, or returning to PCC. Yeah, and in the Educational Master Plan, I'm so delighted that what the evidence shows is that we need more counselors and more help for students.
Now, What were you looking to expand through the EMP and the counseling services? I'm sure you have tons of great ideas. Share them with us, please.
Yeah, we'd like to expand our online services so that students, especially our new students, they have this sense of being connected through the web, and we want to be able to offer that help through our online services.
Now, what have you heard from students? I'm sure you get tons of feedback, whether you want it or not, from students about what is lacking and what they'd like to see.
What's lacking is access to counselors, so you'll see that our lines are extremely long, and there are students who have needs that go unmet every single day. So I'd like to be able to meet their needs and basically, just provide them with the assistance that they're yearning for.
Now, you talked about online education. Is there any other technology way that can actually ease the burden of the counselors in long lines?
Absolutely. We currently do not have an online educational planning system, or not a robust system. And so if we had that, something that was connected to the actual student scheduling system, then students would be able to quickly glance at their educational goal and determine which classes they need to take in order to meet that goal. So I'm hoping we can be able to fulfill that portion of the educational master plan.
But students will still have access to counselors as much as they can, obviously with the budget constraints, for face-to-face time.
Absolutely. What we'd like to do, though, is make that face-to-face time with a counselor, reserve it for the students who need it the most, and then provide all of the other assistance through online or, providing group sessions so that students get information in a group. But then that one-to-one time will be reserved for the students who do need it.
Now, I know when I was many, many years ago, when I talked to my counselor when I was an undergrad, I didn't need the entire 30-minute or hour session. Is there any idea of how maybe splitting that up or just maybe answering one question a student may have?
Yes, we've currently implemented quick counseling. So I have this mobile unit that we can pull out and assemble where a counselor is available in the hallway, right here in the quad, in the campus center, in the library. And so we are making ourselves more available to students for those quick questions.
Well, excellent. Is there anything else you want to tell us about counseling and how great it is and how it's so useful for students? And I mean, really it is.
Yeah, I think that people would be astounded to know that we see 30,000 students through appointments a year.
Wow.
And that's just in counseling. In my educational advising center, it's more than that. So we do see a lot of students. Unfortunately, we haven't seen everybody, but we do have so much business, and we're trying the best that we can to meet everybody's needs.
And with the Educational Master Plan being one of the action items to grow counseling, obviously counseling is so important that it's actually built into the plan.
Yeah, I know. I think it's going to contribute to the success of the students. And so we're just really happy. It's finally come to the day where people are acknowledging the importance of counseling. And so my staff feels great that they're valued, their work is valued, and, we're looking forward to scaling up. So.
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Cynthia.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back.
Wow, after so much on the Educational Master Plan this episode, I feel like I just got a degree on the subject. What about you, Juan?
Well, the EMP really covers a lot of things. It basically is going to dictate how we offer services here at PCC for 5, 10, 15 years. But if you want to learn more at home, go to pasadena.edu and go to our Project 90 link to learn more about the EMP.
And thank you to all the guests that gave us interviews this episode and last episode as well. And that's a wrap for this episode of the PCC Today Show.